Das ist ein Wetter. Das ist ein Wetter. Okay. So, I'm very happy to be here again. And the lecture I give today is about some quite recent research. Half of it appears in the Journal of Symbolic Logic, but you can see it on archive. And the other one is not yet written. So the point is like this. This is about so to say, a dual to the famous proof notion of David Hilbert. So the greatest revolution in mathematics has been the introduction of the axiomatic method by David Hilbert. And the revolution is so profound that the people cannot even remember how it was before. This is the reason why you can very often read that somebody says, yes, so these Greeks approved this, but so really correct this proof is not. Because they cannot even remember what proof meant before Hilbert's notion of proof. So this notion of proof is very recent, and we cannot even imagine that. So everybody, I did not write it, knows what the Hilbert proof notion is. A proof is a sequence of formulas, where every formula is an axiom or instance of an axiom, or follows directly by rule application from formulas with lower index, some sort of an atomistic formulation. And of course, in proof theory, this was widely kept. I mean, in that sense, one took tree-like proofs because one needed the regularity in many aspects. One took infinitary but well-founded proofs, so quite similar. So one kept to this Hilbertian notion. In reality, one kept it. Now let's look at the following. That will a little bit appall you, I would think. The following conclusion. The Kurt Gödel is Austrian entails that Kurt Gödel is Austrian. Okay. Hence, that Kurt Gödel is Austrian entails that everyone is Austrian. That you would not eat. That is, if Kurt Gödel is Austrian, then all people are Austrian. Therefore, there exists a person such that if that person is Austrian, then all people are Austrian. That is correct. And so the figure of the proof is this, and we see what happens. What happens is that the eigenvariable condition in the classical sense is hurt, is violated. So the eigenvariable occurs in the lower sequence. And in reality, my talk is about such weakened eigenvariable conditions. And what is the impact? That means is to say the aim before is that one goes back to the global notion of proof, where the proof is as a total object sound, but the subproofs are not necessarily sound. That was how this was before Hilbert, sometimes in mathematics. And please, at any point, interrupt me. We have time. I can explain and so on. This is
by global soundness, you mean that the conclusion is correct?
Correct. Nothing yes. More. Nothing more. So that means also that the soundness of such systems cannot be established by induction. So we all know that the soundness proofs, contrary to the completeness proofs, are exceedingly easy. Yeah, so to show the soundness, you see the axioms are sound, and from sound formulas you come to sound formulas. Here this doesn't help, obviously. So we need complicated soundness proofs for such context. This is a traditional way, and this is directly in the Hilbert concept of proof embedded. So what we are after will be some form of a weaker regularity. We will keep properties of the eigenvariables. We will keep properties, but they are weaker than than the usual properties. They entail the usual properties, but they are not entailed by them. One is that we have to keep the regularity. The regularity means that an eigenvariable should serve only for one inference. Or in a weaker form, that an eigenvariable should serve only for the inference of the same formula. So if it occurs on different bases, it should exactly infer the same formula. That what one called weaker. And now, for the other conditions, we have to look at the concept of site variable. This is basically a quite easy concept. The site variable is a variable that occurs in the inference of a strong quantifier. A strong quantifier is a quantifier which has an eigenvariable. So for all right, there exists left in usual classical LK. And so the point here is we look at the site variables and the eigenvariables, and what will be there, we will assign an order to them, or relation. And the point will be that this relation should be acyclic. Yeah, the relation should be acyclic. So, scholemization is of course clear, that we all know. And now comes the condition. So the characteristic variable do not appear in the conclusion. This is a really important and in the end only really global condition. The eigenvariable which can occur in the lower sequence should not occur in the conclusion. The site variable condition, the relation is acyclic. And third, this weak regularity. And this can be in even a weaker form. And so we have two calculi. The LK plus is a calculi with this regularity, and the LK plus plus will be that with the even weaker regularity, that the eigenvariable can occur more often in a strong quantifier inference, but then the same formula has to be.
Could you perhaps explain what is a weak quantifier inference?
Yeah. The strong quantifier inferences are the inferences of which rely on eigenvariables. So in LK, what we are here discussing, it is for all right, there exists left. And the weak inferences are those which infer from a term without any condition. This is exist right and left universal. Okay. So the LK plus is like the LK, only that we replace the eigenvariable conditions by this weakened form of eigenvariable conditions. And the LK plus plus is the same. The only thing is that we allow even a weaker regularity than before. Okay, now we have to establish the soundness. And I said that this establishing of soundness is not that simple. And this argument, in fact, so I will not hide my ich will aus meinem Herzen keine Mördergrube machen, I do not know the English variant. So I will think where these things come from, because you see immediately that these rules are sound if you use a translation to epsilon calculus. Yeah? Immediately. Yeah? But the referee of our paper, unknown also, I think I know him, but I cannot say this, gave a much, much better argument, and we use this argument here. This argument is credited to the Journal of Symbolic Paper referent of our paper, of this paper of Juan Aguilera. So he suggested to do the following. Instead of making epsilon, whatever, an epsilon theorem, we simply don't do the quantifier inferences. That means we infer an implication left. A of A implies for all x AX, or the dual sink for the existential quantifier. So up to the end, this is only propositional and it is sound thereby. And now we have to get rid of these conditions. That is, so to say, the point. But the idea is quite simple. By the acyclicity of the eigenvariable condition, you know that they cannot occur vice versa. So you know, so to say, an infimum, and this cannot occur elsewhere, otherwise the other one would have, it would loop, Yeah? So the infimum is the minimum under that order, the minimum under that order, and that fulfills the eigenvariable condition. And the difference is if we have the LK plus and the LK plus plus, in the LK plus plus, we have to contract because there could be several variants of it with the same variable. But they are propositional contractible. Then we infer this, the eigenvariable contains no value. So it's an eigenvariable in the usual sequent calculus, and we infer the existing x left. And then we cut out this formula. And the formula is, of course, a sound classical first order formula. It has a form, the existing x brackets a of x implies for all x ax. And this we cut out. And by the way, we have translated it back to the sequent calculus LK, but with additional cuts. With additional cuts. This and this will play an important role. So. And now, it is of course clear, so a sequence is derived in LK plus, LK plus plus, then it's already derived in EK. And here you see the example why this acyclicity is such necessary. So if you allow the same thing, but without asking that this relation is acyclic, the rest the same, you will get for all y the existing x, x, y implies the existing x for all y, x, y. This is a derivation. And this is, of course, nonsense. Yeah. So in fact, the cyclicity is not accidental, it is necessary. And in reality, only to go back to this global notion of proof, the acyclicity and the regularity, these are local conditions, yeah? Because you could imagine you allow an inference only if it doesn't produce a cyclic master. Yeah? And there's only one real global condition, and this is the non-occurrence of the eigenvariable in the n-sequent. So, now let's look at the proof in LK and a shorter proof in LK+. Now, any proof theory which is done for the fun of it. I mean, we do proof theory for the fun of it. But scientifically seen, any proof theory which is done for the fun of it is bad proof theory. So proof theory should have an effect. There should be a result. There should be something that the analysis brings. Yeah? And in that case, we will have a complexity result. And this is, of course, not so that this is accidental, that the proof is shorter than the other, or reason of aesthetics, because there is no elementary function bounding the length of the shortest cut for LK proof of a formula in terms of the shortest cut for LK plus or LK plus plus proof. That is the statement. And now we will devote the next half an hour such to prove this statement. So the most technical thing, and this is, I will not give here, but you could see it in the archive paper, is a matter of fact that this calculus with the weak and eigenvariable condition simulates another calculus, which is, so to say, a rather clumsy one because there's many, 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 many rules, but in a certain sense also a natural one, namely the calculus of all quantifier shifts. It means you consider the LK and you allow in the cut-free format to shift around the quantifiers. Not to distribute them, to shift them. You can, for example, go from A for all x, A implies bx, where x is not contained in A, to O A implies for all x, bx. And this is the calculus LK shift, which has many, many, many rules, as you can imagine, in and out, and in and out, and in and out. And this calculus is simulated by the calculus with a weak quantifier condition. Now, the proof is a little bit hard, but I will give you the intuition for that. namely as a double exponential. So what is the reason? The reason is that, of course, why the quantifier shifts lengthens the proof is because they block each other. So it can be that if you have a certain position where you should infer, let's say, a strong quantifier for right existing left, but you cannot because the variable is still free. Yeah? And of course, this is the reason why you cannot do this quantifier shift on the spot. That means here I have here a cut-free proof and now I have a cut-free proof of another quantifier configuration. You cannot do that because you have such blocking things. And these blocking things do obviously not exist in this LK plus and LK plus plus format. Still, you need a little bit of transformation, but it is an interesting aspect that this is only double exponential, which is not much, so it's nearly as propositional. You should think that, for example, if you eliminate cut in the propositional cuts, you get normally an exponential increase. But if you do it not, so to say, piecewise, you get double exponential because of the result of Urquhart, also the elimination of atoms can cause one exponent. So that is not that much. But the interesting aspect is we will now prove that the shift calculus, in fact, has non-elementary shorter proofs. And this has even a, so to say, certain historical significance, because you should think that the main error of Herbrand in his paper was that he thought that the shift of quantifier do not change the Herbrand disjunction. What they do. But we will see that the Herbrand disjunction not only changed, for that one can get very easy examples, but it is changed in an outrageous way. So there are cases where this grows non-elementarily by the shifts. Yeah? And so how to prove that? So this is a statement. There is no elementary, there is no elementary function bounding the length of the shortest cut-free LK proof of a formula in terms of this shortest L cut-free LK shift proof. Yeah? In these arguments, you usually use so-called worst-case sequences which show the non-elementarity of cut elimination in an operational way. That means you don't really have to know what that worst-case sequence is. So there are several. There's one by Orevkov, there is a different one by Stedman, and there is an even easier to understand one in the proof theory chapter of Budlak. They are nice, but they are different things. Orevkov has no terms. Stedman has, so to say, only universal axioms and more or less an intuitionistic argument. Budlak is the best understandable one because he mirrors the exponent, which is contained here. So we take such a sequence. So the condition is the size of this proof should be polynomial, but that's not really important. The big advantage of this type of complexity theory is that the differences are so outrageous that one exponent, two exponents, three exponents doesn't matter. Yeah, so we do it much easier than. And of course, it's always a relative complexity theory. If in absolute terms, first order logic is undecidable, not recursive. So what we have here, the size of the proof is polynomial. There is no elementary bound. The size of this proof with cuts, however, is polynomial bounded. All cut formulas are closed. The last thing is a more interesting one. By quite easy transformation, one can transform any cuts in the Brennex form, in classic logic only. But this needs more and more cuts. Therefore, one of my most beloved problems is there an elementary procedure to eliminate cards from a proof is one Renex card only. Okay, but you take this, and so you transform the proof. So the oldest trick is, of course, when we have closed Renex cards, we can do it. Otherwise, we should have had universal quantifiers to close it, because Elgashev has usual eigenvariable conditions besides. But it is only technical, so in reality you don't need it. So we infer A implies A instead of the cards, and this is a card-free proof. But here's in the antecedents, A copies of A implies A. Yeah. And now we have to look what happens with this A implies A. Now, with the shift calculus, we can of course now shift all these quantifiers out without much increase of the length, and we position them in the following way: that the weak quantifier always precedes the strong. So when we have, for example, for all x a x implies for all x a x, then we have for all x there exists in y, so a y implies a x in that way. Always the strong quantifier is followed by the corresponding weak quantifier. Okay. So this was short. And now we show that in LK, no card-free proof, no short card-free proofs of these statements exist. And this can be easily explained by an indirect argument. So we assume, and this we can always do, that let's say outside of these formulas arising from the cards, everything is, let's say, universal on the left and existential on the right side. That can be obtained by schoolemization, and one should mention that in the card-free case we can deschoolemize, so we can do that always. So we take statement sequence, which anyhow is of that form. And now the point is like this. So we assume we have such a card-free proof, and then we can schoolemize it. Schoolemize by substitution. So a card-free proof can be schoolemized simply by replacing strong quantifiers. So for all x exists y, a x y will be replaced by on the left side by for all x, a x f of x, and on the right side by a the existing y, a c y. So always the strong quantifier is replaced by substitution. This is a proof theoretic way to schoolemize, and the proof theoretic way is interesting because the schoolem function it uses are never used as functions, so there is no identity axiom on them. This is, by the way, also the difference, because it was discussed recently with Fyodor Bakumov, why it is so easy to deschoolemize in Avogadro's case, where they are functions. They are functions. Yeah, so you have your function axioms. So, okay, so this becomes something like of the form A. For all x, a implies f of x, and so on. Now, assume when we had a short proof, we had a short Herbrand disjunction, and now I start to change the Herbrand disjunction. The Herbrand disjunction is a tautology. So when in a tautology I replace all terms of a certain kind by other terms, it remains a tautology, whatever that is. So what I do now is that I have here a, and here I have f of a, and so there stands in this column in the Herbrand disjunction t and f of t, and I replace f of t everywhere by t. That means I project these column terms to the opposite term. Yeah, and I started with the innermost and so on, and repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat. But in the very end, the situation has to change, and this becomes the form C implies C, for whatever. Now, the whole thing is a tautology, and we have in the antecedent C implies C, we can delete it, it remains a tautology. So I obtained a small Herbrand disjunction, and this is a contradiction to the choice of the example, because the point is that the statement in this example, the Herbrand disjunction has to be low, as long as the cut-free proof is large, and if the Herbrand disjunction would be small, we get also a small cut-free proof. So that is the essence of this argument, and therefore we have this non-elementary difference. The interesting aspect is, of course, we have this cut-free proof, which in reality encodes cuts, because from the soundness theorem we have seen that there were cuts. Yeah? There were cuts. And the interesting aspect is these cuts are, so to say, carried by the format. And that has consequences. I come to that. But first, let us discuss everything which is of advantage, is also of disadvantage in another aspect, is the world is just. So that format doesn't work for intuitionistic logic in pasta. So we see here already the example why it doesn't work. This has no cut elimination for the easy. The other one has, of course, as we can eliminate these cuts in the usual LK. But that has no cut elimination. Why? Because if it had, then we could prove these statements cut-free. This statement doesn't contain strong quantifiers. Therefore, it is a statement of LG itself, a statement of intuitionistic logic. And this is not a valid statement of intuitionistic logic. So in this proof, the cuts cannot be eliminated. The reason is exactly connected to this quantifier shift. In a certain sense, this plus and plus plus calculus always express the quantifier shifts. And in intuitionistic logic, not all possible quantifier shifts are valid. Astonishingly few are not valid, so these are these three. But this is sufficient. And this is in fact the thing, so you can ask what can you can prove in LG++, then it is intuitionistic logic, but plus is quantifier shifts. So, of course, another price we pay, and it has an interesting consequence, I think.
So this intuitionistic logic with all these quantifier shifts, is it different from this
It is, because the propositional structure remains. Yeah? It is also the intuitionistic logic in the epsilon calculus, in the usual. If you take the usual epsilon calculus, you get that. The claim of Bell is not technically but methodologically doubtful. Bell wants to claim that intuitionistic logic with epsilon calculus is always classical logic. He is by this choice function, so to say, attracted. But that's not the case, because what comes out is on the propositional level the same, but on the first order level it is different. We have these shifts. So this format is simply not suitable for intuition, which is not harmful here, but which will be harmful in the next chapter, I think. So then you have this scolemization knot, which you will usually have in LK. Because if we had, we again could argue like that. We take the proof, the cut-free proof, scolemize, and then de-scolemize in LK. So we get a short, the proof remains short, and the de-scolemization costs an exponent. After a paper I wrote with Stefan Hetzel and Daniel Weller, costs an exponent. Discrimination, and therefore you had a way to come shortly from a cut-free proof in LK plus to a short cut-free proof in LK. So the usual scolemization doesn't work. And here I want to say something what has to do with why this type of research is of maybe interest. Yeah? You see, very often such phenomena are explained, which are observed already in automated serial proving. One doesn't know why. Because there's a second scolemization. The second scolemization is called the endo scolemization. The endross columnization is simply called so. The endross columnization makes the dependency of this Coulomb function only from that variable that occur in the formula where the quantifier states. So if I have, let's say, I have the left side, the negative side, I have the existing x, a, x, y, and this stands in the quantifiers of a scope of y and z, then it will not depend on z. Yeah? And this is sound, one can give a quite easy soundness by structural definition a soundness argument. And this endross columnization is therefore used in automated scene proofing. And they have the fundamental problem since many years, which is solved by that, that they do not know how to eliminate the endross columnization, to go back to a first order format. And the reason is because they try to go back to a card-free format, naturally. And in reality, they have to go back to a format with cards, and they can go directly. This, for example, explains. Yeah? Then another interesting aspect is that we have here cases where the usual card eliminations do not work. Why Genzer-style card elimination doesn't work? We have seen this example of an intuitionistic proof where the cards could not eliminate. Now, a Genzer-style card elimination procedure, however you define the priority, this is not unique because you can't go up with the rank here and there and so on. But however you define it, and this is one of the great achievements of Genzer's paper, an intuitionistic proof, as a proof with right restriction, will be transformed in an intuitionistic proof. And this one has no card-free intuitionistic proof, so there is no Genzer-style card elimination. There's interestingly also by a more complicated argument, no Schütte-Tate style card elimination, if you make a direct card elimination. What of course exists is this embedding where you add cards and then you can make a normal card elimination. But otherwise it's only the epsilon theorem who would lead it directly. And so we come to this relation of the epsilon calculus, which is so to say the origin of this research. If one speaks in proof theory, one should distinguish between epsilons and taus. This is simply for the symmetry. Of course, Hilbert was happy that he needs only one operator, the epsilon. And in classic logic, tau is definable, but for symmetry reasons, you should keep tau. By the way, there is an interesting, very funny theorem. One can show that that if you use epsilon and tau, you get under some circumstances much shorter Herbrand disjunction than if you use epsilon alone. And now you might ask why. Because in the epsilon calculus is the better, the fewer critical formulas belong to an epsilon term. Now if you use only one type, epsilon, then naturally much more will belong to the, and you can construct examples for that. Much more will belong to one critical term, critical formulas, than if you have two, because there will be fewer. So this is a strange statement, maybe. Okay, but here we simply look at the epsilon variant of a sequent calculus that only has these weak inferences, as we all know, that in epsilon calculus, strong quantifier inferences disappear, because they are substituted by the epsilon, the eigenvariables are substituted. And now it turns out that these plus and plus plus calculi are in a certain sense halfway, they are halfway between epsilon calculi and the normal calculi, because they have this different eigenvariable behavior. However, there is a second thing of the epsilon calculus, and the second thing is inner quantifier inferences. So you see here such an example of inner quantifier inference. The epsilon calculus can overbind bound variables that no other first order format can do. And therefore it had peculiar and a quite different behavior, what it also always made interesting to me. So now we come, so to say, to a second place, which is the title, the more recent research, where curiously I had to fall back on exactly these considerations. So what are hanging quantifiers? Hanging quantifiers were functional quantifiers introduced by Leon Hankin in the namesake, and by an untraceable paper which exists, it said so. The interest of them is that they are quite natural, because you see, if you would, for example, in the linear algebra express things, these are the direct dependencies, so you do not have to code, you can express it directly. And they have the second property that they are incomplete, so they are already second order logic. It is interesting that this very small Hankin quantifier, the only one I will speak about, is already of the strength of second order logic. Consequently, there is no effective proof system. However, this doesn't deter us proof theorists, because we have many such systems for second order logic which is either incomplete. And now the question was to establish an analytic system for these Hankin quantifiers. Let's do a first approach. So in the literature there's very few about this, with exception of a paper of Lopez Escobar, where he does this in connection to an intuitionistic natural deduction system. However, he lacks the elimination rule. And in Dacutis' book, the Hankin quantifier occur among the heterogeneous quantifiers. But in all cases, we have not the rule for the, let's say, left side. The rule for the right side is quite obvious. The term T1 should contain at most the A, and the term T2 at most the B. They should not be vice versa contained. This is natural, and it fits to the function form. The left rule is already a little bit less natural, and we have to think about why we come to that. Namely, we have here the condition that n pair eigenvariables, different eigenvariables. We are here in the normal format still, so they should not occur in the lower sequence. They should occur at most opposite, and one of the two should contain none of them. So the two rules occur from the fact which of the one stroke, the two stroke, does contain none of the eigenvariables, either that or the other. And how we come to that? This is simply derived, let's say, from a simple function calculus. Maybe the most natural one is a weak one, so normally not considered in proof theory because it's so weak. And it means it is a calculus of the term models. It means the existential is simply a functional relation. Yeah, that's all. So these are the natural rules. And if you look at these natural rules and you think that your inferences in the Hankin quantifier format, they should simply be the premise extendable to the premise here, then you see exactly these conditions. Because of course you cannot in both cases substitute effort in each other, this would circulate. Yeah? So therefore this restriction. So something we can prove. We prove something. This is simply proof. Nothing more is to be expected. Yeah. The de-Hankinization, so to say. However, the theorem admits cut elimination. This is quite easy to understand, because we have in that case, we have only one. I forgot to mention that this Hankin quantifier, of course, simulates by dummy application existence and universal quantifier. I should have mentioned that, so we can have the other quantifiers also. And in reality, the cut elimination becomes simpler than, let's say, in Gensen's case, because we only have to consider one quantifier case. Of course, with two rules. So there are basically two things. And what we have to find is a common substitution in the eigenvariables, such that it's the same propositional formula. And here is the substitution. It's a little bit, a computer can calculate it easily. Unifications are one of the good things of computers. not for humans, but for computers. So this would be the second thing. Okay, we have got illumination, and now comes the debacle. This calculus is incomplete for any reasonable partial semantic, and incomplete it is anyhow, but it is incomplete in a sense for most idiotic statements, and for that statement. And why it cannot be derived the statement? It is very easy. We have cut elimination, so if it had a proof, it should have a cut-free proof. Now in the cut-free proof, somehow, we have these two atoms and the C. And we have this atom and the C. So we should start to apply the quantifier on the left and on the right side. But the eigenvariables on the left side are blocked on the right side, and the eigenvariables on the right side are blocked on the left side. So no inference for this statement.
And if one considers that, let's say, second-order semantics for Hankin quantifier, in terms of functions, right? So
yeah.
It's translatable into a certain framework of second-order logic. So what would be the, let's say,
Exactly. This is to full second-order logic, sigma, whatever. Mm-hmm. This one is, of course, designed on a much weaker thing. Mm-hmm. And you might also ask why...
second order is really all Hankin quantifier or something like that?
Already that. So the other Hankin quantifiers from the power of semantics do not bring much. I mean, this was in a certain sense an observation which was fascinating on that you have this simple additional condition of functionality and in that very moment already it becomes incomplete. But the problem is here not the incompleteness, as I said, because Hankin quantifier is anyhow incomplete, sondern the problem is the silly incompleteness. And now one might ask, where does the silly incompleteness literally come from? And then one understands that it is a much more general phenomenon and not connected to the Hankin quantifiers. It comes from the fact that if you consider, let's say, the function calculus and derive the quantifiers there, you can consider this as a macro, as also the rules were derived. And this macro is put apart. So you would first make the inner Wolf quantifier, starting on the weak side, the strong side, then going to the other side, making the strong set and then the weak set. And this means that you cannot have this quantifier macros. This is this mixture. And this already is in the most simple case of classic logic. So you cannot have a usual calculus. So for propositional logic, you always can do that. So for example, if I consider non-A implies B or NAND or NOR or whatever. Immediately I can design sequent calculus rules which are analytic, cut-free, etc. How I do that? I take, for example, the premises of this macro. Yeah, so I put together the premises and that's easy. Or I can also derive it directly from the semantics, from the truth table. And here with quantifiers it doesn't work because the strong and the weak inferences block each other. Typically, you have no problems to have the usual calculus for blocks of quantifiers of the same kind. So there's a string of universals, string of exponents, that doesn't matter. But it is here the mixture which is the problem. And this poses the same problem. And the interesting thing is that we can overcome that by using the same technology we had before, but not for complexity reasons, but for reasons of existence. Because in a plus, for some reason we have to take the plus plus calculus, come to that later, but in the plus and the plus plus calculus, it is clear that you can simply make both inferences and postpone the effect. Yeah? So in that sense, you can deal with these macros. And of course, you might ask, what is the point in dealing with macros? So why should I not put it apart? But the point in dealing with macros is, for example, that you have a calculus where to prove a certain configuration only uses inferences on this configuration. Yeah? Otherwise, you have got no what for configuration of inferences. You're right, left, and so on. So, this is one of the reasons to be interested. The second reason has to do more with automatic theorem proofing designs, which I don't speak about here. Namely, it is so that if you have this function calculus, which easily defines Hankin quantifiers, and there's a certain demand for automatic theorem proofing with Hankin quantifiers for the reason that the Hankin quantifiers are so intransparent. So to say already, the simplest configuration of Hankin quantifiers cannot intuitively understood, and the automatic theorem proof easily can do it. So there is a demand, but the automatic theorem proofing in all formats, so the main format are, for example, Tableau or resolution, for classic logic, in all formats it fails when functions are involved. There are no reasonable proofer for functional context, and the reason is not the incompleteness or whatever, the reason is the fact that there's no that functions incur second order unifications, and therefore you cannot make the closure steps in a reasonable way. So if you have second order unification, you cannot say anymore, okay, I get the most general unifier and then I continue. Yeah, so you have a plethora of unifiers which traits behavior. The behavior can be extreme. It is not, let's say, with semi-unification where this is nearly decidable and has a smooth behavior. Here, all the behavior of all the Fountain equations come in. Yeah? So that really doesn't work. And this is the reason to look at it. So what is the solution here? And of course, I have to say this is a work in progress, so it is not the most simple form at the moment. It would be that you do the same concept as before, but you have to introduce valuations for the variables. You have to use valuations, and the valuations are of course commuting with the terms. Yeah, so the values of a term is a union of the values of its variables. And now we do the same thing as before. We make these rules. And it looks still, I have to admit, a little bit complicated, but it's not that complicated as one thinks. I explain it. So the eigenvariables, which are true eigenvariables, are only valued by themselves. Then the valuation excludes the occurrence of eigenvariables where they shouldn't be. And that are the old side variables. Nothing else. You look at the side variables outside of the quantifier and you have to put all, so to say, concepts in order. That is sufficient. And the same thing happens here, but here is already pre-calculated that you want, if you verify the thing, here is the only verification to translate it to the function calculus. Yeah. And if you verify the things in the translation, you will introduce FT1 for A and FT2 for B. So the rest remains the same. So this is the thing. So I think one can still considerably simplify that. And now we can derive the silly thing. Yeah? We can derive the silly thing. This, of course, proves nothing. I only wanted to show the derivation. These are the valuations, and we have that. And don't think that you get this valuation only retrospectively. You always can consider these orders as part of the rule. So you apply the rule only if the orders are respected, otherwise you don't apply the rule. The non-occurrence in the end segment is the only really global thing. So, and now what you do is the obvious thing. you consider this function calculus in the obvious way, as we already discussed, and we do the same things as in Elgar plus. We make an LF plus and an LF plus plus in that sense. We have here the very weak regularity, the rest is exactly the same. Whether the functions are zero placed or real function variables, it doesn't matter. But the order condition is the same. And in that sense, also the same argument leads to the correctness of that relative to the user. So the function calculus can be re-embedded in itself. The Hankin calculus cannot. So, yeah, this is the same thing, we derive in LF plus plus and it's derived in LF. So what is now the idea? The idea is now to take this derivation in the Hankin theory and translate it in the, it is a plus plus derivation, one could say, so not with usual eigenvariable conditions. But it can be translated directly in this LF plus plus derivation simply by taking the valuation and taking the objects out of the valuation and giving that object in the order. Then you get an LF plus plus derivation. Then you get a cut-free LF, so to say you get from the LF plus plus derivation an LF derivation with additional cuts, you get a cut-free LF derivation. That this has cut elimination is quite simple because it's a weak theory, you can make the cut elimination exactly as similar to RCR zero. I mean, simply you have rank and degree and the usual thing. So that's easy. But then, what you do then you have a cut-free Elgar plus, Elgar proof, and now you block the quantifier inferences. You go back to Elgar plus plus format by, so to say, putting the quantifier inferences for these macros, only these macros occur in the end sequence, because we have a translated statement from the Hankin quantifiers in a simple form. And so we put them together again. So again, it is a plus plus calculus for the simple reason that now we have these hanging eigenvariables. That is, so to say, the argument to put together. So the LH plus plus is sound cut free complete with respect to the intended semantics and admits an effective cut elimination. However, this cut elimination cannot be done within LH plus plus. It cannot be done within LH plus plus. So to say this plus argument doesn't work because the supporting formulas are not derivable. Yeah, but we can translate it to the function calculus, eliminate the quantifiers there and retranslate it in data. We have a mid segment theory, this is obvious, and we have some sort of a strange Erbrand theorem, namely, if we derive only that, and don't forget that it is in the end a P2 formula, yeah, then we have a Herbrand disjunction of this form. And this Herbrand disjunction is then already derivable in the original calculus. The propositional formula that is derivable in the original calculus, and the quantifiers can be in the reverse order inferred. So, of course, you might ask what is all the pain for, besides the automatic theory proving part. So, in a certain sense, this is an example of a projection of a second order concept, of course, a partial concept, to the first order level. So this calculus is on first order level. This is, as I said, important for automatic theorem. And in that way, you can treat all Hankin quantifiers. But it is not clear whether you can treat all quantifier macros. And the reason is the following, also quantifier macros for all the exist and so on. So you can make any formula and it's a macro. Why this is not obvious? The reason is that in this blocking argument. So in the blocking argument, we knew there's only strong quantifiers followed by weak quantifiers followed by strong quantifiers, that's easy. Now, a more complicated quantifier prefix could be inferred in many, many different ways. And how you could, so to say, rearrange the proof that the macros stand there before you retranslate it in the original calculus, this is not clear to me. So it would be, of course, a strange phenomenon if some quantifier configurations have analytic calculus and others have not. Yeah, but it might be, I don't know. Another question is, of course, you could, this was more an exercise in doing it, you could go to stronger semantics, as a stronger calculi. The difference is not essential. The hanging quantifiers, of course, are, so to say, popular in linguistics, and therefore came this question of the calculi, because there's a discrepancy that all the results about hanging quantifiers and similar quantifiers by the Scandinavian schools, Finnish school, and so on, they like that quantifiers, they are semantic. So they show that this is strong as God knows what. But the linguists, they want to analyze sentences. So they are interested in, does a certain hanging quantifier imply another configuration of hanging quantifiers? And these questions are very hard to answer. They are hard to answer because, of course, the incompleteness phenomenon, and they are even hard to answer in the positive way. That means how to establish that such an implication really holds. So by semantic argumentation, that's very hard, and therefore there's a certain demand for a calculus here. But for me personally, the most interesting phenomenon was that I did this analysis of the unsound rules for a completely different reason, and suddenly I needed it. Yeah? So I wrote a project about that. In this project, I made the error by claiming that it will work in the usual sense. The reference didn't detect the error. It was a complicated error. And suddenly I understood that it doesn't work. You have to have some sort of unusual calculator to deal with such phenomena. There is no help. And on the positive side, one can say that such calculator might help to deal with other phenomena of a similar kind. So again, for example, the reason why one claims that something is piano or arithmetic is induction, is no analytic calculi, is because from the known formats of analytic calculi, you can extract information which contradicts this. So for example, it is obvious that there is no analytic calculus for induction in the usual LG format, because if it were, you had a Herbrand disjunction. If you had a Herbrand disjunction based on the language of polynomials, then the exponential function would be a polynomial piecewise. Yeah? And so that is not the case, and consequently such things doesn't exist. Already in the example before, one has seen that not always one can extract the Herbrand disjunction from a countable proof. Yeah? So in that case, you need transformation. You have to re-embed it. You have to eliminate the cards, then you find the Herbrand disjunction. And so studies of that kind may raise the possibility to find suitable different formats even for stronger schematized induction or other things. Okay, I think that was all what I wanted to say.
Okay. Questions?
So, so you started the story about this hanging, quantified by saying that this fails for a stupid reason. Then you showed how to eliminate this stupid reason by somehow going to this format of incorrect proofs. So.
Yes.
Okay. And then you said, okay, in these incorrect proofs, you have a certain calculus which is sound and complete for the intended semantics. So you, what kind of semantics you mean here?
This is the very simple semantics, of course, the Hankin semantic, the very simple Hankin semantics of term models. So the term models here are all functions of the formula plus free functions, countable many. That doesn't matter if we have any other identity.
So did these people in Hankin quantifiers consider such
models? No. They always looked only on the on the real second order, and this is a discrepancy. So I was originally attracted by the discrepancy. I discussed these things with there is a well known and very dominant proof theoretic linguist, Rettore in Montpellier. He was originally a proof theorist, and he's interested in such things. And here I discussed it. And the point is this discrepancy. The linguists want really to know sentences to be true. They are not up to complicated things, and it is hard. Yeah? I could easily write you a Hankin sentence with only say an implication with three Hankin quantifiers on the left and three Hankin quantifiers on the right side, and you will think for long whether you consider this true or not. Yeah? And of course, this calculus is also not very transparent. But as I said, it serves as a basis of automatic theorem provers, and they can answer such questions easily. So, for example, quantifier string A implies quantifier string A is one of the things that the easiest can be solved by theorem provers of both formats. Yeah? So it came from that. Yeah? So this is of course a very simple semantics, but the point is not the partial semantics. One could use stronger than the card elimination.
The reason I ask was the following. So if you design a certain calculus which you then show possesses certain nice properties like it's an analytic calculus, it's card elimination, so usually this is supported by somehow natural kind of semantics. So even if calculus is incomplete with respect to some intended semantic, like real second order, maybe certain class of structures with which.
This is a quite natural semantics. But I said the weakness or strength of this calculus is not so important. So if you would think of much stronger functional calculus, the difference would be that you could define much more functions. Yeah, but this doesn't deter the argument, one could say. Again, this correspondence remains. Yeah, also the plus plus and normal, it's the same more or less. Still I hold that this semantic is natural. So this form of Herbrand theorem would not hold in other semantics, yeah, because it makes the dependency up to a certain degree explicit if there are few quantifiers. Yeah, and this is what Herbrand theorem does usually. In that sense, yeah.
Okay.
Please? Now there is a question from a student who is following our seminar over the internet.
what for a technology, I'm impressed. This is an interesting question, what people always say when they don't know the answer. I don't know. The problem is in a certain sense that I personally, but nested quantifiers might do it, I know too few about them, nested sequence. The problem is in general that, so to say, this, I have not seen a reasonable analytic format for intuitionistic logic with classical quantifier shifts. I do not even know what is that for a semantically for an object. I have no clue. I have really no clue. What is intuitionistic logic with all classical quantifier shifts? One is constant domain, but the other ones is I can could go back to these axioms. I could go back to the well, sorry, what I do now. I could go back to these axioms and I say what they are. Yeah, okay. Let's go back to these axioms. Yeah, and this is also the same argument. Oh, sorry, yeah. Yeah, exactly. So that is constant domain axiom. But the other two are some sort like a constructivity axiom. They say an infimum is a minimum, and they say a supremum is a maximum. But I do not know in how far that is in a so to say, non-ordered aspect.
Yeah,
for sure. I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so as always, if you want a good proof system, you're spreading.
So this is, by the way, also the epsilon calculus of intentionistic logic. Yeah. So I have no clue, but it is basically an interesting question, because this system is not as silly as it might seem, because you could say, okay, I do some weird thing, I combine classical aspects with intuitionistic, what should that lead to? But the system is not as silly as it might seem, because let's say similar interpretation is the epsilon translation, always produce such. Yeah? So when you instantiate, therefore it was polarization doesn't work for intuitionistic logic. So in that system, for example, semantically polarization would work if I had all these quantifiers.
So that's the weakest system over intuitionistic logics, which is sound, so to say, for epsilon.
Exactly, scolemization, epsilon. So it is not such an unnatural system, because let's say I'm interested, let's say, in the constructivity of the OR, but I'm not, the quantifiers can be what they are, then you end up with such a system, yeah? But I have no semantic view what it could be. It's not the first time I confronted with that. So this is the answer to the student. I think it is an interesting question to find such a system, but a hard one. It would be very interesting to have a system of that kind.
Another innovation, that this is the system where you can present every formula in a Brennecke form.
Right. Yeah. You have every formula in the Brennecke form. And it is only three, because all the other shift rules hold. There are many. So but only these three. This is fancy. And another strange aspect of this plus-plus calculi is that they have the usual cut elimination only when you extend them by cuts, and then you eliminate the cuts. Yeah? But if you so to say want to eliminate the cuts directly, no cut elimination, which is known to me, but the epsilon theory, that works. OK, can translate it to epsilon calculus and epsilon theorem, and then you have a Abrantes junction and get the cut-free proof. I think it was a quite technical part of our paper, and we did not, as for this non-elementary point, we did not look at it. To my personal intuition, I think it can be single exponential, because from the single exponential you will not come away, because you have up to a certain degree shift things. But I think double exponential is too much. But in double exponential, it works for sure. And in single exponential, you would have to work hard. It is not proven. Yeah? With exponentiality, what is in fact proven and what is very similar? So that the lower bound is exponential, that you can easily understand, that you can already understand from the following matter of fact. If you have the de-scholemization of a proof, and this goes into a Brennex form, yeah, then the de-scholemization more or less is immediate. It doesn't change the length of the proof. However, if it goes to an infix form, which Stefan Hetzler and Daniel Welle have proven in our joint article, then there is an exponential lower bound. And that is explainable by the fact that scholemizing, which costs nothing, and de-scholemizing can encode a quantifier shift. Because you say, let's say you scholemize for all x, a, or b, x, then you have some scholem function in the x, and then you say, oh, yeah, this was the scholemization of a or for all x, b, x. So I de-scholemize I. So my scholemization and de-scholemization, I have the quantifier shift. Yeah? So and this is exponential, this de-scholemization, and for that reason, exponential is the lower bound. But from the exactly the same argument, one can get the intuition that maybe it is also the upper bound.
No more questions? Okay, then we will end this thing.
Thank you. But I'm very much impressed at